Well, it's Christmas next week, and I remember as a kid, Christmas always seemed to take forever to get here. But nowadays it seems you just get over Christmas and bang, it's here again. It just seems to be going that quick nowadays. And they tell me that happens when you get older. So I must be getting pretty old because it just seems to be a continued cycle of Christmas, Christmas, Christmas. But Christmas is an interesting time. You know? It's a time where people that don't believe in God will happily sing songs about God. You know, songs such as "Hark the Herald Angels Sing." And they'll praise and glorify God, even though they don't believe in. But it's the only time of year that they'll do it, at Christmas time. You know, and I always like watching at work. You know, at work it's always interesting. Guys that never talk to each other, at the end of the shift, the last shift before Christmas, will go around and shake everybody's hand and wish everybody Merry Christmas. Even the guys that they don't like, they'll actually shake their hands and wish them Merry Christmas. So it's always interesting, Christmas time. And I want to look briefly today. I'm not going to speak very long. I'm going to just want to look briefly at the first Christmas that occurred 2,000 years ago, and just want to look briefly at three of the main characters. And you can pretty well work out who the three main characters were in the Christmas story. And the first person was Mary. In Luke chapter 1, verse 26, it says, "Now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and having come in, the angel said to her, 'Rejoice, highly favoured one. The Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women.' But when she saw him, she was troubled at his sayings and considered what manner of greeting this was. Then the angel said to her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favour with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son. And you shall call his name Jesus. And he will be great and will be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end.' Then Mary said to the angel, 'How can this be, since I do not know a man?' And the angel answered and said to her, 'The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore also that the Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. Now indeed, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age, and this is now the sixth month for her, who was called barren. For with God nothing will be impossible.' And then Mary said, 'Behold, the maidservant of the Lord, let it be to me according to your word.' And the angel departed from her." Now I love Mary. You know, Mary was humble. You know, the angel Gabriel turns up and just praises her up, that she's highly favoured, she's blessed. And rather than get the big head and say, "Wow, yeah, I am," she's troubled by it and ponders it. Now Mary, you know, for any woman to have what occurred to Mary, you know, even an experienced older woman, would have been a pretty big burden for an angel to suddenly appear and say that basically you're going to bear God's son. And Mary was a young lady, and there's some debate on exactly how old she was. You know, various ages range from about the age of 12 to around 16. Most people seem to think she's probably about 13, 14, 15 years old. So, pretty big weight to bear on a young lady's shoulders. And she was engaged to Joseph. She was a virgin. She'd never been with a man before. And she would have had dreams and plans as a young lady. You know, she's engaged, so she would have been planning her wedding and on how her wedding was going to be and where were they going to live, how many kids were they going to have. What, you know, and she would have been chatting away with her friends and dreaming about life as a married woman, what it would be. And then an angel appears and tells her that she's going to have a baby, but not Joseph, but by the Holy Spirit. And in those days, you know, it's a bit different nowadays, but sex before marriage was a definite no-no. So you can imagine, you know, she gets told that she's going to get pregnant. What was she going to tell Joseph? What was she going to tell her parents? What was she going to tell her friends? You know, she risked a lot of trouble in her life. You know, she risked bringing a lot of shame on her family, on herself, on Joseph. But what was her reaction? She says, "Behold, the maidservant of the Lord, let it be to me according to your word." And she was like, "Okay, God, you're in control. You're in charge. You know, do what you have to do." So sometimes we can be a bit like Mary. You know, we have all these plans. And we come to a fork in the road and we think, "Okay, I've come to this fork in the road, I'm going to go left." And God says, "No, you're going to go right." See, sometimes we have to change our plans when they don't line up with God. I know it's happened to me a number of times. Mary was obedient to God. She had all these plans, and God readjusted them and changed them. And her reaction was, she didn't get aggro. She didn't say, "Well, no, I've got this plan. No, I'm not going to." She said, "Okay, let it be as it is." Mary was obedient to the leading of God. And then we've got Joseph. Joseph's engaged to Mary. And he's probably a bit like Mary. They've been working out the wedding, where they're going to live, what sort of life they're going to have. And then suddenly he finds out that she's pregnant. Not to him. And she comes up with this story. It was God that did it. And you can probably imagine what's going through his mind. You know, his girlfriend suddenly appears and tells him that she's pregnant, but God did it. You know, it's not my fault. It's all God's fault. Have you ever done that? Blame God? It wasn't my fault. It was God that did it. Well, that's what Mary did with Joseph. It wasn't my fault. You know, it was God. And he would have been in the same boat as Mary. You know, he would have faced shame and ridicule from his families and friends. And they would have said, "Well, what sort of girl were you going to marry?" But he doesn't fly off the handle. He doesn't try and shame her to make himself look good. Because that's what the world teaches you. You know, if you want to look good, pull somebody else down. Make them look bad to make yourself look good. The easiest thing for him to do would be to dump her and shame her. But he doesn't do that. If you look in the book of Matthew, in chapter 1, verse 18, it says, "Now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. After his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not wanting to make her a public example, was minded to put her away secretly." So we often skip over that. Mary, as a pregnant woman, who wasn't pregnant to her fiancé or husband, was guilty of adultery. And the punishment for adultery was death by stoning. So Joseph had the right to have her executed. But he wanted to protect her and not shame her. So he decided what he would do, he would divorce her, break the engagement off secretly, and protect her. And he was trying to work out how he could do that without bringing harm to her, without bringing shame to her. And it goes on, it says, "But while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, 'Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to make Mary your wife, for that which is conceived is of the Holy Spirit. And she shall bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sin. So all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, Behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and I shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated God with us. And Joseph, being aroused from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded him, took him as his wife, and did not know her till she brought forth her firstborn son, and they called his name Jesus. So Joseph was a man of integrity. You know, his main thought was not, how can I look after myself? How can I protect myself? How can I make myself look good in this situation? His main thought was, how can I look after Mary? How can I protect Mary? I don't want her killed. I don't want her shamed. I don't want her ridiculed. How can I look after her? And the Holy Spirit says, look, you know, leave it to me. He was a man of integrity. He honours Mary, and in the process, he honours God. And then they travel from Nazareth to Bethlehem, which is about 70 miles, which is, for all those people that like metric, because we are Australian, we're not American, 113 kilometres, which is a 10-day journey. Now, thanks to Google, 113 kilometres from here is Berwick. So they travelled on a donkey, not down the Princess Highway, because the Princess Highway wouldn't have been there, it would be a bit more bumpy out than that. But it was a 10-day journey, and you've got to remember, Mary's 9 months pregnant, riding the donkey. And as I said, it wouldn't have been a nice, smooth road like the highway. It would have been up and down bumps and winds and turns. And I can imagine in a 10-day journey, often they would have just probably camped by the roadside. So, pretty uncomfortable. I've never been 9 months pregnant. Sometimes I look like I'm 9 months pregnant, but I'm not 9 months pregnant. But I've had a wife that's been 9 months pregnant. And it can get pretty uncomfortable at times, so I've told. So they travel 70 miles, a 10-day journey, on a donkey. And when they get to where they want to get, there's no place for them to think. So I imagine thinking, okay, it's a horrible 10-day journey on this donkey, but when we get there, we can have a relaxed, nice, comfy bed, have a shower, wash. And they get there, there's nowhere for them to stay. The only place available is out in the stables with the animals, which is not an ideal place for a 9 month pregnant woman to have to sleep and give birth to a baby. But not once in Scripture does it say that they complained. Not once in Scripture do they whinge and complain about what's happening in their life. You know, they could have said, well, God, we are carrying the Messiah. You know, we're doing your will. We're doing what you asked. How about giving us a few miracles? You know, a nice clean room would be nice. A doctor and a midwife would be nice. A nice bed with clean sheets. But they didn't complain. A lot of people do get caught up in complaining to God, you know. And I've done it before. You think, okay, God, I'm doing what you asked me to do. How about a few blessings getting chucked my way? Why is I'm doing your will, why are things going badly? And we complain and grumble. But not once, I can't find in Scripture, that Mary and Joseph complained or grumbled. I think God knew what he was doing when he chose Joseph and Mary. And then we come to the third character in this story, baby Jesus. So if, and you're probably lucky I'm not God, because I would have messed it up a long time ago, but if I was God and I was going to do something like come down the earth, I would have made a pretty more dramatic. You know, I would have come down and power and glory, you know, a bit of music, you know, like in the movies and stuff like that. But God chose to send Jesus as a baby. Nothing more defenseless than a newborn baby. They're totally dependent on other people. God didn't come as an all-conquering hero in a blaze of glory, but as a defenseless baby born in a manger. He came to show that there's more to the relationship than just the creator and creation. He came as a newborn baby so he could identify with mankind. He can identify with each one of us. He can identify with the defenseless because he was defenseless as a baby. And you remember that the devil knows his scriptures. And he knew something was going on, and he just couldn't figure out how. So it was a pretty big risk for God to say, okay, I'm going to send Jesus down as a newborn baby. Because he was on his own. So he can identify with the defenseless, because he was defenseless as a baby. And throughout his life, people were out to get him. He can identify with the marginalised. He didn't come as a ruling Roman, but he came as a Jew. And even as a Jew, he was marginalised by his own people. He can identify with the poor, because he wasn't born into a rich family. He wasn't born with a silver spoon in his mouth, but he was born as the son of a carpenter. In Luke 9:58, Jesus himself said, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." Jesus didn't own, throughout his life, didn't own any material wealth. He didn't have a house. He didn't even have a donkey. He can identify with those who face temptation, because we read in Scripture many, many times Jesus was tempted. We're told at the very start of his ministry, he went out into the wilderness and was tempted by Satan himself. He can identify with those that have been rejected, because even his closest friends deserted him in the hour of need. And he can identify with the falsely accused, because he was falsely accused of many things and suffered death because of it. Christ came as a man to reclaim man's birthright for what man was created for. Adam and Eve were created to have a right relationship with God, free from sin and condemnation. But the man Adam in the Garden of Eden gave it away, and only a man could reclaim it. God gave all authority to mankind. When he created Adam and Eve, he gave them all authority, gave them dominion and power over everything. But when Adam fell, he gave that authority to the devil. Man gave it away and only man could claim it back. That's why Jesus had to come as a man. Christ came because, as we're told in John 3:16, he loves us so much, he gave his life. He came to give us life, and life more abundantly. See, Christmas is a time of celebration. Christmas is about gift giving. And Christmas is about the greatest gift ever given. Christ. God gave all he had. He gave himself. Now the world tries to remove Christ out of Christmas. You know, if you notice lately, there's a lot of happy holidays instead of Merry Christmas. Or it's Merry Xmas. They remove Christ. But Jesus is the reason for the season. Without Christ, there is no Christmas. Christ is the greatest gift ever given. And it doesn't cost us anything. That's the good thing about a gift. When you get a gift given to you, you don't pay for it because it's a gift. You just have to receive it, take it. And then it's up to you what you do with that gift. Christ is the greatest gift. It didn't cost us anything, but it cost him everything. What we've got to make sure we do is we don't leave that gift unwrapped under the tree. We've got to unwrap it and we've got to use it. We've got to receive it. We've got to receive Christ and allow him to flow in our life. You know, I've heard a saying many years ago that the greatest gift God gave us is our life, and the greatest gift we can give to God is what we do with our life. Christ gave his all as a gift to us. What we do with Christ in our life is up to us to do. We can leave it unwrapped under the tree like many people in the world do, because Christ came for everybody. Christian, non-Christian, Muslim, non-Muslim, devil worshippers, he died for everybody. You know, it says, for God so loved the world. He didn't clarify it and say, for God so loved the Christians in the world. No, he came for the world. So don't leave that gift of Jesus under the tree, but receive it, unwrap it, and use it. Merry Christmas, everybody. And God bless.